Jesus, Lord.
Yes, thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. When I look at this here, I want you to understand that God, number one, made everyone and everything that there is. It's hard to understand. I will never understand it, but the Bible says he made everything visible and invisible. Amen. There's some things you can see with the naked eye. There's some things you cannot see. But everything was made by him. The word became flesh. And understand here that mankind, you and I, are the highest order of God's creation. In other words, when you look, amen, at all of creation, only mankind was made in the image and in the likeness of God. Pastor, what do you mean here? You look at the fact here that, and God can do whatever he wants to do because he's sovereign. Amen. God doesn't have to answer to anyone. But when he said, I made mankind in my image and in my likeness, God says, I want you to look like me. I want you to walk like me. Now you might say, well, isn't God a spirit? Yes, he is. And a spirit is invisible. A spirit is non-material. A spirit is indestructible. You can't destroy God. Amen. You can send off all the nuclear weapons that there are, and you cannot destroy God. And let me tell you something, and I know people think, well, you know, they're going to blow up the world. Look here, God is in control of the world. And I don't care how many nuclear bombs they have. There are some bombs we know there are, and there's some that we don't know. But God is in control of this world. He's not going to let the earth be destroyed by mankind. Come on, somebody. Now, I didn't say there wouldn't be a fallout. We're a country where we know what war is about. But I want you to understand here that as we look at this, everything was made by God, but the enemy wants to actually blind us of the fact that we were created to know God and to serve him. When we look at the scripture, Acts 20:28, since God is a spirit, the Bible says he purchased the church with his own blood. You have to ask the question, when did God ever have blood since he is a spirit? Well, obviously, God had blood when he became a man. I told you this morning in Sunday school, God put on a man suit. Y'all remember back in the days they had jumpsuits and leisure suits? Some people still wear them, leisure suits. Well, God put on a man suit. Hallelujah. God became man, and yet he was still God. The human part of him, he was able to identify with us through human eyes what we are going through right now. As a servant, he became the greatest servant leader there is because he put himself in the earth and became vulnerable to the attack of his own creation. So much that they looked at Jesus, they didn't believe in his authenticity of who he was, and they tried to bring accusations they did against him, but none of the lies stuck. Praise the Lord. He's still the great I am. Let's give the Lord some praise. Amen? But it was important for him to put on a body so that he can purchase the church and bring us back to God. I want you to understand here, he purchased the church with his own blood when he became a man, and that blood, thank God for the blood of Jesus, that was shed on Calvary, it was that blood, amen, that he used to bring you and I back to God. There's some key words I want to put in your mind this afternoon. The key words are these: purchased, made, or created. The word bought, B-O-U-G-H-T. Another word, a key word this afternoon is price. When you think about price, you think about value. You think about worth. Yeah. Amen? Another word I want to put in your spirit this afternoon is ownership and possession. All right? Yeah. Ownership, possession. These words here are key as we look at today's exhortation, because we must understand, number one, all mankind was made by God, but the focal point isn't creation, but rather redemption. We'll talk about redemption. We're talking about here someone, amen, that has been given the gift of salvation. Salvation has been given to us by his work on Calvary. Amen. Give me a little bit more on this mic, Brother Sanchez. Amen. His work, it was his work on Calvary. It was his beatings that Jesus bore in his body for you and I. Praise the Lord. Amen. It was a chastisement, praise God, of the punishment that was taken out on one man, the Christ Jesus, in our place. So understand here, the value that God placed on your soul being saved is more than all the money there is in the world. The value that God places on your soul being saved is worth more than all the gold in the world. Understand, as we look at this here, the focal point here, there has to be something greater in value than just being created, because we're not, we don't belong to God just by creation, otherwise nobody would be lost. Amen. We belong to God by redemption. Hello, somebody. It takes the blood of Jesus, praise God, being operated in your life for you to be able to walk in the light of his word. It takes to being able to understand here that the blood, praise God, has never lost its power. The blood today is still redeeming man, bringing you and I back to a place of justification that we can have rightful fellowship with our Creator. It's a gift. When we look at Calvary, we got to understand this afternoon the worth of the blood of Jesus. We must understand also, praise God, that in order to be brought back to God, God obviously had a purpose in mind to bring us back to him. He goes on and let us know here within his word that you haven't chosen me, but I have chosen you. He goes on and says here that you were lost, you were alienated from God, but God sent his word to bring us back to him. Yes. He brings us back to a place of understanding that without him, we can do nothing. The Lord lets us know here, as we look within the word here, that God so loved the world, hallelujah, that he gave. I'm happy about this, because when you think about it, and you think about the spirit of adoption, God could have said, well, I'm going to pick you because of this and pick you because of that. But all of us were faulty. All of us had flaws. All of us had polluted blood, praise God, and none of us are worthy of being saved. But God said, beyond all of your faults, beyond all of your shortcomings, beyond all this, I'm going to pick you up out of the world and sanctify you and set you in a right place that I can deal with your mind. So understand here, the grace of God is a work that God initiates to the believer. We cannot come to God except God give us his mind. We cannot know God unless God reveals his word to us. Amen. Understand, the mission in life here is that we might be so in love with God that we have eternal, everlasting brother fellowship with him. Because understand, this earth is not our home. Why is it many times we try to be comfortable in a place that God never destined for us to live forever? But he said, I'm coming back from my church. So look back here at Acts 20 and 28. Purchased with his own blood. When I look at this here, as I was preparing for this message here, God told me to tell you that he said, I love you beyond of your shortcomings. He said here that in your flesh dwells no good thing, and therefore, because he understands our flesh is rebellious, our flesh is corrupt. Amen. You might say, well, Pastor, I've got the Holy Ghost. That's right. You've got the Holy Ghost. Your Holy Ghost is in your mind. The Holy Ghost is in your soul. But the fleshly body you carry around is corrupt. Amen. The old man never wants to believe God. The old man, the old nature, never wants to serve God. The old man, y'all can talk to me this afternoon, amen. The old man never wants to believe God and stretch out on his word. The old man runs away from God. The old man tries to justify him or herself, saying, I'm not all that bad, and tries to put itself in a place where even God ought to be able to accept. But let me tell you something here. God is not accepting things of carnality. God is not accepting the world into heaven. Amen. Praise the Lord. The Lord told us in his word in 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse number 17. He said, come out from among them and be separate and touch not the unclean thing. He told us in another writing, love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. All that is in the world is the lust of the eye, the lust of the flesh, and what? The pride of life. Amen? So obviously, when we look at this, if God is saying here, I'm going to make a covenant with you, you got to know here that you're going to be blessed, amen, when you work on behalf of doing what God tells you to do. God said, I want to bring you into a covenant relationship, but there's some steps that you got to do. Amen? As well, I take my time as I go through this. The Lord said here, when you come out from among them and you allow yourself to be separated because of the new desire that I put within you, God said, I'm going to walk in you and I'm going to talk to you. Amen? He said, you're going to be my sons and you're going to be my daughters, but he said, come out from among them and be separate. As we look at this, I want to ask you a question here. Do you really know this afternoon how blessed you really are to be a child of God? Do you understand today how blessed you are to be a recipient of living water? What am I talking about? I'm talking about being able to be a recipient of the Holy Ghost. Jesus told the woman at the well, if you knew who I was, you would ask of me, and I would give you living water. How many times do we not really gain all the benefits from God because somehow along the way we stop asking God for our needs? We stop asking God, amen, for the things, amen, that we need to overcome. God said, you have not because you ask not. But if you knew who I was, you would ask me, and I would give you the virtues of life. Let's give the Lord some praise in here. Amen? So if you only knew who I was, you would ask of me. Jesus said, if you only knew or appreciated who I am, that I am the God, praise God, the God in the body, and I didn't murmur, I didn't complain. I didn't find it, amen, a heavy thing to be able to take away the sins. Like, as a willing servant, Jesus knew exactly why he came into the world. He knew what his mission was. Do you understand today that God didn't just come into your life for you to feel good about yourself, but he came into your life because he's got a mission for you? Do you understand today that many individuals say with their mouth, you know, you've heard it, Lord Jesus, come into my heart, but the heart is talking about your mind. See, you're saying the whole lot when you're asking the Lord into your heart, because God is not going to be someone, amen, who's just in your mind, amen, taking up space. He's not going to be an individual that's going to be a partaker with a divided mind. What I'm saying this afternoon, Jesus says, I want all of you. And if I can't have all of you, I don't want any of you. Amen. See, some of us, we have a way of putting up with a little bit of this and a little bit of that. But this afternoon, I'm talking about making Jesus the Lord of your life. When you allow the Lord, and understand here, understand the nature of God. Don't fool yourself. God does not make you serve him. God is not a God that is an abusive God. Some people you know in your life, they tried to make you like them. They tried to make you love them. And through their games and through their schemes, they tried to finagle their way into your life, only to find out sooner or later that the light came on, amen, in your life, and you realize that this person has got ulterior motives. God is not like that. God is saying here, I'm your Redeemer. Amen. I'm your Savior. But I've given you a free will to be able to choose whom you will serve. So as a Lord, even though I'm Lord, I'm not going to come in unless you give me permission. Come on, somebody. Amen. You might say, well, Pastor, why doesn't the Lord just do it? God says, I want you to love me because you want to love me. I want you to serve me, amen, because I want you to know my nature. I want you to know that I'm a God of judgment. I'm a God that is jealous, amen. And you ought to be glad that God is jealous over you. Do you understand that God doesn't want, if I can use a phrase, God does not want the devil messing over you? You know, we are permitted to use that word, amen. You and I are the property of God. Maybe you didn't know that. You don't belong to yourself. You sign your name on documents, and that's your name. You have titles and leases and arrangements and agreements. But understand, I don't care how many times you sign your name, you don't own anything. Amen. I don't care how many times you put your name out there, you got to understand that Jesus is the Lord of your life. Amen, somebody. You got to understand, he's the Lord of everyone. Thank you, Jesus. And since he has redeemed you, he has brought you into the kingdom, amen. He says, in other words, I purchased you, and therefore, get this, people of color, I own you. Don't no man own me. Jesus owns you. Ain't no man going to tell me what to do. Jesus owns you. Jesus owns me. Amen? When I go where I want to go and I do what I want to do, that's right. But at the end of the day, God has got the last word in your life. Amen? At the end of the day, you can run, amen, and you can walk away from God, but at the end of the day, amen, you're still going to have to answer to him. Let's give God some praise in here. Now, I think the question ought to be here, since God is the master specifically, since Jesus is the Lord of our life, I think we need to ask ourselves, how do we feel about Jesus being the Lord of our life? How do we feel about, amen, his word, and you can write this down, his will is his word, amen? Brother Sanchez, a little bit more on this, please. His will is his word. Say this with me. God's will is his word. So if he's going to be the Lord of me, then therefore his word has got to be the ruler in my life. This means here, God is saying that your will has got to line up with the will of God. So understand here, God is not going to change who he is for you. See, there are no prima donnas in the kingdom of God. Hello, somebody. There are no Paris Hiltons in the kingdom of God. There are no Kim Kardashians in the kingdom of God. Hallelujah. Amen. Praise the Lord. You're only somebody if God makes you somebody in the kingdom. And whatever glory you have, all the glory and all the honor belongs to God. Let's give God some praise in here. Amen. So God, number one, has redeemed us. God snatched us out of the hands of the enemy. God put us, amen, and pulled us up out of the miry clay, and God brought us into a new and a living way. And it says here, you've got to make your will His will. So what you're really saying, Lord, that I really don't have a will. Amen. Do you understand when you totally sold out to God, you don't give God your opinion, you just say yes. When you totally sold out to God, you don't try to finagle your way out of tests and trials. You don't try to manipulate the mind of God and say, Lord, I want this test and I don't want this test and I want this trial and I don't want this trial. And when Jesus is the Lord of your life, you just say, Lord, give me the grace to go through. Give me the strength to go through. And God, whatever's in my cup, I'll drink it. I'll drink all of it. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. You might say, Pastor, that's a hard thing, making Jesus Lord. Let me tell you something. You can get so in love with God, you don't care what man says to you. You can get so in love with God, you don't care about the reactions of others. Amen? What I'm saying, you have to be so in love with God that you got to realize that, number one, God is going to uphold His part of the covenant, of the agreement. You just got to make sure that you're determined with your, in your mind to serve the true and the living God. Let's give God some praise in here. I've got to make my will His will. It's not a time here, amen, to deal to get out of tests. It's not a time to try to make a deal with God to get around responsibility. But it's a time here to understand that disciples, get this, and soldiers are made. This means here it's going to take some time for you to develop and to bring the disciple God wants you to be. It took some time with Peter. Peter, you know, he realized, Lord, I'm willing to die for you. But he didn't realize, he didn't really have what it took when tests and trials came on. He found himself, amen, denying the Lord when the heat was on. Let me ask you a question here. It says Jesus is the Lord of your life. How do you react when the world comes up against you and says there is no God? How does that make you feel down on the inside? Amen. When the world tries to blaspheme the name of God and tries to walk all over. Because you are a child of God and you're connected to God, it ought to rub you the wrong way. When, amen. There ought to be something rising up within you. Amen. When you look at, amen, all of the unbelief of the world system. What I'm saying here, when Jesus says He's Lord of you, you got to understand that you got to be, number one, emotionally connected to God. What God loves, you got to love. What God hates, you've got to hate. And as a soldier, you have to discipline yourself into making your soul flesh do what it doesn't want to do. Do you understand your flesh never wants to believe God? Do you understand your flesh never wants to serve God? Amen. Let me go a little bit further here. Do you understand here that God is calling the church to a level of maturity? If we're not careful, we'll find ourselves, amen, being ruled by the wrong masters. If we're not careful, we'll find ourselves, amen, being ruled by our feelings. Amen. The master, praise God, of sorrowfulness. Oh, I'm so sorry, I can't go on to see the future. Don't let sorrowfulness be your master. Amen. Come on, somebody. Amen. See, there's a sorrow. The Bible says that worketh death. If there's going to be a sorrowfulness, let it be a type of sorrowfulness that works, amen, repentance toward God. Amen. There's a time to be sorry, but it's got to work repentance toward God. The sorrowfulness of the world only worketh death. But don't, amen, allow yourself to have the wrong master. You must not have the master of depression and anxiety and stress. You must not allow the master, amen, of fear to take dominion over you. Because God has not given you the spirit of fear. Let's put our hands together and give God some praise. You must not allow, amen, the master of confusion, amen, to allow you to go, amen. You don't know whether you're coming or going because your mind is always in a state of confusion. When you are confused, you open yourself up to the attack of the enemy, amen. People who don't know who they are, people who don't know what their mission in life is, people that don't have any goals, amen, they allow themselves, amen, to be vulnerable to the attack of the adversary. You got to know that God has got a plan in your life, and the plan that God has for you in your life is that you would know who he is and know that there's power in the name of Jesus. You can't afford to be confused. You cannot afford to have drama in your life. Family, co-workers, instigators, always want to stir up something and use that word mess again in your life. Amen? Do you understand here that the enemy is working about to get you to be entangled in the affairs of this life? But as a soldier, you got to be wiser and smarter, amen, than the traps that the enemy has out there. Come on, somebody. Don't have the wrong masters. Look at the neighbor, tell him, amen, don't have the wrong master. Don't let the wrong master get a hold of your mind. Let me ask you a question this afternoon. Who do you want to lord over you? Who do you want to lord over you? Thank you, Jesus. Who do you want to yield to? And the question I have to ask you is why? Who do you want to go to when the wrong masters and the wrong spirits try to attach themselves to you? Thank you, Jesus. Why do I use the phrase, who do you want to go back to? Because I find out that sometimes when we're striving to do what God would have us to do, we fail to remember that, number one, the Lord said, I came into your life because I want to rule everything in your life. I want to be the king in your life, not only in title only, but I want to be the king of your life in deed and in action. Which means here, not only have I pulled you up out of the miry clay, but I want to show you that I'm able to keep you in 2014, no matter what the enemy throws at the world. And then when the enemy throws it at you, it should not have an effect on you, because you've made Jesus to be the Lord of your life. Get this here, when you made Jesus the Lord of your life, then you've got a rest in God that surpasses all of your understanding. See, when Jesus is Lord of your life, it doesn't matter what world you're in, amen, you're in, you understand it's only for a set time and the season. Come on, somebody. Amen. When Jesus is the Lord of your life, amen, it doesn't matter what type of confusion the enemy raises up, amen, and throws in your life, because you understand that God must be up to something. Understand, let me know here that God loves you this afternoon. How many understand here that God is not detached from you? See, people, when they know they can't do for you, they will answer your phone calls. Amen? When the phone rings, you're like, Lord, I need somebody to come through for me. Sometimes your friends are going to let you down. They don't even mean well, but their resources may be short. They may be short of money. They may be short of patience. Amen? They may be short of understanding. Amen? But when all your other hopes and your stops are pulled away, you got to know today that the Lord said, don't be afraid because I am on board. Amen? I mean, how many happy today that the Lord is on board? Amen. You ought to be happy this afternoon. Thank you, Jesus. I want to ask you another question here. How long does it take for you to come into relationship with him, with Jesus, the one true Lord? How long does it take for you to come into a real relationship with him? How many tests of trials you have to go through before you start to realize, I need to stop trying to govern my own life and fix my own problems and do it my way I need to take my hands off the steering wheel. Better yet, I need to get out of the driver's seat and stop trying to drive my own life. And I need to let the Lord in the driver's seat. I need to let him take control, amen, of the steering wheel. Amen. If God wants to hit the gas, that's his business. If God wants to hit the brake, that's his business. I need to let the Lord drive me. And I just need to get in the passenger seat and enjoy the view. I wish I had a worshiper in here. How long does it take for you to trust him? How many trials do you have to go through before you realize that you're making it harder on yourself than what it ought to be? Amen. How many times do you forfeit your joy and forfeit your peace? Thank y'all for that. Amen. Sometimes my blessings go over the pulpit, don't they? How many times do we throw things away? Because the devil said, oh, God ain't got that for you. God ain't coming through for you. You don't pray, you don't fast, and apparently your Lord doesn't care for you. But I just come to serve the devil notice here today. I just come to let you know, and I believe that you believe with me, that I need the Lord. I need Jesus to be Lord over me. I need to realize from time to time that I don't have it together. If I'm trying to fix my own trials, if I'm trying to fix my own problems, I need somebody bigger than me, greater than me, stronger than me, wiser than me. I need a Lord over my life that cares about me. Amen. I need Jesus, Lord of me. I need Jesus, Lord of me. Thank you, Jesus. I need a God that knows what true relationship is all about. I need a God that's not going to run out on me. Amen. When I'm going through my tests and my trials. Amen. When my mind says, oh, not again. I need a God that's going to stick with me through the thick and through the thin. Amen. So I come to ask another question here. If you want Jesus over you, amen, but are you willing to trust him in every circumstance? If you want Jesus Lord over you, are you willing, amen, to stop asking the why question and just ask the Lord, just give me the strength to go through it? Amen. Now, if you're going to ask the Lord why, ask the Lord, whether, Lord, what are you trying to get out of me? Because apparently you're leaving some haters in my life for a reason. Because if you're after you wouldn't have any haters, amen? But apparently you got some naysayers, some people that don't believe in the power of God that's in your life. You got some people that don't believe in your walk. They don't believe in your talk. They don't believe that you really know who the Lord is. And apparently God is moving, amen, some hard-headed people in your life to be able to prove something to you and to them. Sometimes God leaves some hard-headed people in your life, amen, because he wants to know whether or not you're going to hold up under the test. And God said here, look, he believes in the integrity that he has put within you. Much like Job here, when he said, well, you must have done something wrong, you got to understand here, Job could easily fall into the trap. Well, gee, maybe I'm not as saved as I thought I was. Maybe I don't have the faith that I thought I had. Amen? Look here, when Jesus is Lord of your life, you got to know how the enemy comes, amen, to pull away and take away your faith. When Jesus is Lord of your life, you need to listen to him, because the Holy Ghost will let you know, amen, can I use the word, how that rascal's going to come? The devil will let you know that God doesn't love you, God doesn't care about you, you might as well give up, but you need to let the devil know that Jesus is still Lord of my life. You need to let the devil know, and you need to serve the devil notice that there's one Lord over your life, and his name is Jesus. You need to let the enemy know, and all these wrong spirits that try to test themselves to you, amen, that God is up to something. God would not have covered me in his blood. God would not have filled me with the power of the Holy Ghost if he wasn't going to do a great work down on the inside. So I come to let you know this afternoon, and I'm happy about this. I'm happy that Jesus is Lord over me. I'm happy today because I don't have to worry about money problems. because my God owns everything there is. Amen. Because I'm his child, amen, he's going to supply all of my needs. Amen. How many believe this in here, that when Jesus is Lord, he's got some blessings for his people? Amen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. I need Jesus Lord of me, and you need Jesus Lord of you. Number one, because he made you. And when God made you, he didn't make you by mistake. God made you because he had an image and a purpose in mind. Praise God that you might know who he is. God made you, amen, in his likeness and in his image. And therefore, you got to get to a higher level with God and understanding that God is not done with you. No, you're not everything that you want to be yet in God, but you're still striving to attain, to get to that place in God, amen, when you see yourself differently. Amen. Come on, somebody. Amen. You need Jesus Lord of you. Amen. Because you got some enemies that are trying to bring you down. But when Jesus is Lord of you, amen, you've got real joy. You've got real peace. You got a joy that the world didn't give and the world can't take it away. When Jesus is Lord of you, you realize you got a master that cares about you. You got a master that is not abusive. You got a master that is not indifferent. Amen. God cares about you. If you get too close to the Lord, the Holy Ghost will let you know. Amen. Don't you know that I own you? Don't you know that I redeemed you out of that dirt? I redeemed you, amen, out of that smut. Amen. As a child of God, when God owns you, God said, don't you dare get too close to the Lord. Amen. Don't love them. Don't look at them. Don't envy them. Don't be jealous of them. God said, I own you, I made you, and I can break you. I can build you up, and I can tear you down. I can give you my grace, and I can take my hand off of you, since you think you're so independent that you can do this, do your life without me. God said, okay, just watch me, amen, and withdraw my grace from you. Let's see what you can do now. No wonder David went on to say, don't take your Holy Spirit from me. David said, I did it my way and I messed up. I laid down with Bathsheba, but David said, Lord, create in me a clean heart and renew a right spirit within me. Do you understand? When Jesus is the Lord of your life, you need to be praying every day, Lord, give me your mind. Lord, make me to the man or woman of God you want me to be. Let's give God some praise in here. I know what the devil tells you. The devil will tell you, hey man, you'll never be the man or woman of God that God will have you to be because you don't have what it takes. But you need to let the devil know, amen, that he is a liar and that he's a father of a lie. Amen. God loves you so much. God is not going to leave you hanging. God is not going to throw you away. Jesus would not have went to the cross and get beat up and get tortured and get kicked and get spit on, amen, for you to be left out there in the world. God said, I'm coming to your rescue. God said, I'm going to be the Lord of your struggle. I'm going to be the Lord of your situation. You just need to have faith and believe in me that I'm on my way to rescue you. I'm on my way to drive back your enemies. I'm on my way to bring, amen, righteous judgment in your life. You need to know that I'm a God that doesn't fail. Put your hands together for a God that doesn't fail. Put your hands together for a God that is always right. Put your hands together for a God that never does anything wrong. Amen. Hallelujah. We ought to be glad today that Jesus is the Lord of our life. And we ought to be able to ring it, amen, from every mountaintop. Amen. That I got a new song over here. I don't cry the blues anymore. Amen. I don't have a sad song anymore. I know who God is, and his name is Jesus. I got a reason to live. I got a reason to get up out of the bed and to go to work on a Monday morning. Not just, amen, to get a paycheck, but to let, amen, my co-workers know that Jesus is alive and doing well in this body. Come on, somebody. Come on, believer. Give God some praise. If God is alive and doing well in you, then give him some praise in here. I need Jesus Lord of me. We need a type of God like this that's going to drive back pick us up and hold us in his arms every now and then. I know from time to time, amen, we get rained on. From time to time, amen, the enemy throws things at us. But God said, your trouble ain't going to last always. God said, I'm going to pick you up. I'm going to hold you in my arms. And if I need to shelter you, if I need to baby you, if I need to carry you, God said, because I'm Lord, that's my business. If I want to give you more grace, that's my business. If I want to give you my peace, that's my business. If I want to give you joy, that's my business. You ought to thank God that you're on God's mind. I said, you ought to thank God that you're on God's mind. You ought to thank God that he's thinking about you. Before the foundation of the world, God had you on his mind. Before he made a bush or a tree or a river or a mountain, he had the church on his mind. Before planet Earth was made, already in the mind of God, praise God, God already saw Jesus hanging out there on the cross to be able to bring a people out of the people and to say, I'm going to stamp them in my blood. I'm going to put my name on them. I'm going to put my spirit down on them. So Jesus prayed, Father, keep those that you gave me. They're in the world, but they're not of the world. Keep them through your chest, Lord. Keep them through their trials, God. Let the world believe in their report. Give God some praise in here that Jesus prayed for you. I said Jesus prayed for you. So the results here of Jesus being Lord is I got some real peace, and the devil's upset about that. I got some real peace that's not dependent upon how much money I have or what I don't have. I got some peace that money can't buy. I got some joy that money can't buy. I've got some happiness that money can't buy. Come on, somebody. Because, look at this here. You made Jesus Lord of your life. This means you put him in the position where he deserves to be as Lord of Lord and King of Kings. God said, now you got me right where I need to be. I need to be in your brain. I need to be in your thoughts. I'm going to be in your trials. I'm going to be in your struggles. And God said, I ain't sweating what goes on in your life because I'm in control of this. Do you know he's in control? Do you know he's in control? Do you know he's in control? So we need to take our hands off the steering wheel, and we need to be a worshiper and say, drive, Jesus, drive. Drive, Jesus, drive. It takes courage to take your hands off the steering wheel of your life. Take your hands off the wheel and say, drive, Jesus, drive. Drive my life. Drive the enemy out. Come on, somebody. Lord, drive my issues, Lord. Drive my prayers. Drive my petitions, Lord. You know the desires of my heart. And God said it like this. He said, if you delight yourself in me, if you get happy about my name, God said, I'm going to give you the desires of your heart. But before I can give you the desires of your heart, I need to know that you're happy about who I am. Before I can heal and deal and give you some blessings, I need you to be excited that I went to Calvary. I got beat up for you. I got lied on for you. I got kicked on for you. I got spit on for you. And I didn't murmur. I didn't complain. I didn't come down off the cross. I stayed up there for you. How dare you not praise me? How dare you not worship me? How dare you put your confidence in the wrong place? You deserve your heart to get broken. If you put your heart and your trust in flesh, you deserve to be heartbroken. But God said, if you would have trusted in me, your heart wouldn't have been broken. If you would have confided in me, you would have known that I would have treated you better than the world. Come on, somebody. The world can't treat you like Jesus. Can't nobody do you like Jesus. I said, nobody. 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 Nobody can do you power of his word. So I need Jesus, Lord of me. Put your hand on your head and say, Lord, you be Lord of me. Amen. I refuse to allow the principality of oppression and depression to be Lord over me. You need to move that dark cloud over your head. You need to look up and know that Jesus is over your head. God said, I'm resting on your head. The head of every man is Christ. You are not a drug dealer. You are not an alcoholic. God said, I'm the Lord of your life. You're not a prostitute. You're not a fornicator. God said, you're mine. You belong to me. You're better than sin. You're better than the life that you've been living. You're like a king and a priest. But because of your unbelief, you've been caught up in slavery. God said, don't you know your identity? Don't you know you don't belong in areas as a believer? You got to get up out of depression. You got to get up low, out of low self-esteem. You got to get up out of your doubts and your fears. God said, since I'm Lord of your life, you can't live in the valley. You need to get on the mountaintop and praise me. I need Jesus, Lord of me. Come on, somebody. Tell yourself, I need Jesus, Lord of me. When I first wrote out my title, I had it, I want Jesus, Lord of me. And God said, no, scratch off that word want and put the word me. I need Jesus, Lord of me. Do you understand? You need him to be Lord. If he's not Lord of everything, then he's not Lord of all of you. The Lord has got to be the Lord of your money. He's got to be the Lord of your children. He's got to be the Lord of your co-workers. He's got to be the Lord of your neighborhood. Come on, somebody. You got to make him Lord of your life. You got to make him that. You got to put him on the throne and keep him on the throne. God said, I'm jealous. I'm not going to share my throne with anybody else. The devil's not sitting next to me. He don't deserve to sit next to me. The Lord's spirit cannot reside in your mind. Amen. The devil don't belong in your mind. Tell the devil, get out of my mind. Casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. You got the power and the ability right now to make Jesus Lord of your life. And to take out every enemy. Take out every thought of unbelief. Peter said, Thomas said, Brother, I'm not going to believe unless I can feel the blood prints of the land. Some of us believe we got to see everything about God. God said, blessed are those who are not seen, yet they believe me. In my closing, you don't have to understand everything there is about God to make him Lord. This is where people get off. They think, well, I need to understand everything. No, you just need to trust him. You just need to trust him. You need to trust him, amen? And if the Lord told Peter, I need you to step out of the ship and step on the water, you know you can't walk on water. But the Lord says, come, that the Lord will hold you up. Well, can I be saved? I'm the only one who loves God and my family. God said, I'll hold you up. Well, I come from a home that got this in my family. God said, I'll hold you up because I'm the Lord of brokenness. I'm the Lord, come on somebody, of struggles. I'm the Lord over poverty. I'm the Lord over lack. I'm the Lord over disappointment. I'm the Lord of everything. And I'm not just any type of Lord. I'm Lord of Lords. And I'm King of Kings. Amen. Let's give God some worship in here. Hallelujah. Because I need Jesus, Lord of me. I cannot afford, you cannot afford to entertain the enemy. 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 When you mess up, God loves you. When you come short of the glory, God, he still loves you. When you disappoint God, God said, look, you disappointed me, but I'm not going to throw you away. You disappointed me, but I'm not going to kick you to the curb. See, we throw one another away because we don't meet each other's standards. We don't meet each other's expectations. But God said, my love is not like that because my love is unconditional. I love you through the good and I love you through the bad. When you messed up, I still loved you. And I love you so much that I'm willing to pick you up. And sometimes we almost have to be scraped off the pavement because we're so down and low and depressed. And God said, I got to get my word up underneath you to pick you up. God knows some days we don't feel like praying. Some days we don't feel like fasting. Some days we don't feel like coming out to the house of God. And God said, I'm going to give you your space. There's going to be a time you're going to feel sorry. There's a time you're going to be confused. Amen. But I believe when you get it together, the things that you took yesterday, amen, and maybe last week, you're not going to take those things when you make Jesus Lord of your life. Let's stand and live in the building. Amen. As the song plays,
I am a Jesus promoter. We got a new song that says, we got to be Jesus Lord. Make him number one.
I need Jesus Lord. Amen.
Everybody, I am a Jesus promoter. I got a new song.
What happens?
We got to put Jesus back.
When God rules, he turns our crowns upside down. Amen. I said, when God rules, you no longer have a sad soul because you know he's in control. Lift your hands to heaven right now. Put your hands together, give God some praise and respond to faith. If you need prayer today, come on down to the office. If you want to be brought into relationship with God, won't you come right now? Put Jesus back on the throne in your heart, in your mind. Come on right now. Come on and receive prayer. If you have been baptized in his name, you can come.
Because now they're crying.
Mind trouble, you can come. Come on, put him back. Put him back. Put him back as Lord right now. Don't worry about your money. Don't worry about your bills. Don't worry about that hard-headed loved one in your life. Jesus is Lord of you. Won't you come right now? Won't you come? Won't you come? Can you pray? Won't you come? Put your hands together out there. Let God worship. Jesus said, I've got everything in control. And I'm coming back for my bride. I've given you the engagement ring of the Holy Ghost. I've given you some Holy Ghost ring, amen?
That's the message today. I need to hear the whole church say it.
Come on, believer. You need to shine in the Holy Ghost. It's time for you to be that city set upon a hill that cannot be here. Time for you to break forth in a new praise. Hallelujah. Put him back. God is just full of the gift that was in you. Time to put him back. This week, don't you go forward with fear. Don't go forward in anxiety. Don't you accept the devil throwing mess on you. Jesus is Lord of your life. Amen? And since he's Lord, he says, I'm in charge. Since he's Lord, he said, I'm behind the steering wheel. The Lord drive me. Lord, take me wherever you want to take me. Do with me whatever you want to do. My mind belongs to you. My body belongs to you. Come on and give yourself to him right now. You need prayer? Come on right now. Come on, make him Lord of your life. Come on right now. You don't belong to the world, you belong to him. His truth is true with his blood. You know who you belong to today? Alcohol doesn't own you. Drugs don't own you. Women don't own you. Men don't own you. Jesus owns you. Come on, give yourself back to the King of Kings right now. Come on, give yourself back to him. If you're falling away and you need to come back to God, you haven't been trusting God, now is your time for prayer. Come on, let us pray for you right now. Won't you come? Won't you come? Look at that. Nobody greater.
devils know that Jesus is Lord. He's the boss of you. He's the boss of you. He's the boss of you. He's amazing. Let the Holy Ghost have his way. Only you can put it back where it belongs, amen?
Everybody, only you can put it back. I am a Jesus promoter.
Is he number one in your life?
Song that says, we gotta
is he number one in your life? Is he number one? Hold up your finger. Is he number one in your life? Hold that finger up. Let the devil know Jesus is number one.
Great church, mighty and strong.
If he's number one, yeah, you don't have a sad song. If he's number one, you don't have any fear. If he's number one, you're not worried anymore. Hallelujah. Come on, worship God. If he's number one in your life, I need to see your finger. If he's number one, if he's number one, God, don't put me on the back burner. Don't put me on the back burner. I want to be number one in your life. I'm more important than anybody in your life. Jesus said, I'm the strong man in your life. We're coming back right now. No fear. You gotta go. Y'all, you gotta go. Underneath, you gotta go. I'm making Jesus Lord of my life. I'm not worried about my struggle.
Yeah.
God said, I'm going to redeem my people.
Everybody, bring I am a Jesus promoter. I got a new song that says, we got a God.
Hallelujah.
Make him number one.
God said, you said you were number one.
Yeah!
The Bible said if any have committed sins, let him call
everybody. So I am a Jesus promoter. I got a new song that says we gotta put Jesus back in. Make him number one.
Know your rightful place. Now, right now, I'm just talking about the green machine. There is so much potential in this family. That's why the enemy fights. Hallelujah. But one could chase 1,000. Two could put 10,000 in fight. Imagine what 4, 5, or 6 could do together. Praying and fasting. Hallelujah. I'm going to tell you something. In case you didn't realize it, the devil is scared of you. How many true believers do I have in here? Do you understand the devil is scared of you? The devil is scared of you because of what lives and who lives inside of you? And he's afraid for you to come to the acknowledgement that Jesus is Lord. Because if you ever get this down in your spirit, when you get into tomorrow's test or trial, you know you're going to knock the devil out. Can I do that? Look, you have partnered with God by faith. And since Jesus is Lord, God is going to use you to defeat the enemy. God's going to use everybody in this building to defeat the enemy. God's going to use everybody in this building to prove that he is all powerful. So you will go through this week's test. You will endure this week's trials. You will overcome every giant that is in the land. Pastor, you're prophesying? Yes, I'm prophesying. Because the Bible says greater is he that's in you. I said greater than he that's in the world. The Bible said believer, where the true believers raise those hands. The believer, God said you speak to your mountain. And you may have to start speaking today. You speak to your mountain, be thou removed. And the Bible says, amen, that the mountain's going to get up and it's going to get out of the way.